When we think about which structures in our body surround and protect our brain from harm, the first thing that might come to mind is the skull, acting like a fortress, enclosing and safeguarding the precious brain within. However, the skull alone isn't enough to give our central nervous system absolute protection. Enter the meninges, perhaps the unsung heroes of our neurological defense system, working behind the scenes like a multi-layered shield, protecting our brain and spinal cord and providing them with a nourishing environment. However, even these valiant protectors aren't invulnerable to attack themselves. So what happens when the meninges are under siege? This brings us to the disease called meningitis, which is the inflammation of these protective tissues that can be potentially life-threatening. To better understand meningitis, we first need to learn a little bit about the meninges. The meninges are the three membranes enveloping the brain and spinal cord, protecting them from damage and providing structural support. The dura mater is the outermost of these layers. Dura mater is Latin for tough mother, which is an apt name as it is the thickest and strongest of the three layers. Attached to the underside of the dura mater is the middle layer, the arachnoid mater, with its classic web-like appearance. The deepest layer is the pia mater, a thin and delicate membrane adhering closely to the contours of the brain and spinal cord. Between the arachnoid and pia mater is a space known as the subarachnoid space that's filled with blood vessels and a fluid called the cerebrospinal fluid. These blood vessels and CSF are important for providing nutrients to the brain and spinal cord, removing waste products and providing cushioning by protecting against mechanical shock. Together, the meninges act as a protective barrier, defending against infections and preventing excessive movement of the brain and spinal cord within the skull and vertebral column. Now that we know what the meninges are and their importance, we can understand what happens when meningitis attacks. You might happen to know that there are other conditions in the body which have names ending with itis, usually involving some sort of inflammation. This is due to the fact that the suffix itis refers to disease characterized by inflammation. This is also true in the case of meningitis, as it occurs when the meninges become inflamed, typically due to an infection caused by bacteria, viruses, fungi, or other microorganisms. These pathogens can enter the body through various means, including respiratory droplets, the bloodstream, or through direct contact with contaminated surfaces or sources. Once in the body, they can travel to the meninges and invade to the subarachnoid space. When the pathogens invade the subarachnoid space, the body's immune system recognizes them as foreign invaders. This triggers an inflammatory response, where immune cells are released to fight off the infection. In turn, these immune cells then release various inflammatory molecules which attract even more immune cells to the site of infection, causing expansion of the blood vessels in the meninges. This increased blood flow contributes to the classic symptoms of inflammation, including redness, warmth, swelling, and pain. Unfortunately, this means that the body's own immune response itself leads to inflammation of the meninges and the subarachnoid space. As immune cells continue to infiltrate, the integrity of the blood-brain barrier can become compromised. The blood-brain barrier normally restricts the passage of molecules and cells from the bloodstream into the brain and CSF. As the blood-brain barrier becomes compromised, the subarachnoid space then becomes congested with the flood of immune cells, fluid, and debris, aggravating the inflammation in the meninges. This eventually leads to increased pressure within the cranial cavity, putting pressure on the brain and spinal cord that can have potentially severe complications. Although the incidence of meningitis has decreased over the last few decades, there are still an estimated 9,000 cases and 265 deaths in the UK, and 15,000 cases with over 1,100 deaths in the US occurring every year. Worldwide, the total numbers are an estimated 2.5 million cases, resulting in 235,000 deaths annually. The severity of the inflammation and the resulting symptoms can vary depending on the causative agent, the individual's immune response, and the quickness of the diagnosis and treatment. Meningitis can affect individuals of all ages. However, young children and adolescents are often most at risk. Although symptoms can vary, there are some common ones to be aware of. These can include a fever, severe headache, stiff neck, sensitivity to light, nausea and vomiting, confusion, an altered mental state, and in some cases, seizures. As mentioned, these symptoms vary between the different forms of meningitis. These different forms are aptly named according to the type of pathogen causing the infection. By far the most common form is viral meningitis, often caused by viruses such as enteroviruses, the herpes simplex virus, and the mumps virus. While viral meningitis can be serious, symptoms are often milder than bacterial meningitis and can include mild fever, headache, sensitivity to light, muscle or joint aches, and fatigue. Fortunately, in most cases, viral meningitis usually resolves on its own without specific treatment. A more dangerous form is bacterial meningitis. Although not as common as the viral form, it is more severe and requires immediate medical attention. It can be caused by different bacteria that sound like they're trying to outdo each other in a spelling bee gone wrong: meningococcus, pneumococcus, and Haemophilus influenzae. Symptoms can develop rapidly and may include high fever, severe headache, neck stiffness, altered mental state, skin rash, and sometimes seizures. There may also be other symptoms if the bacteria enter via the bloodstream, including cold hands and feet, joint and muscle pains, rapid breathing, diarrhea, and dark purple or red rashes. Symptoms in newborns and infants can also be different to adults and include being less active and difficult to wake, being irritable, constantly crying, exhibiting poor feeding, having a stiff or floppy body, and a swelling in the soft spot on the head known as the fontanelle. In addition to viral and bacterial meningitis, there are also several rarer forms of meningitis. A couple of examples include fungal meningitis, which is caused by fungi and can occur in people with weakened immune systems or those exposed to fungal spores in certain environments. Symptoms tend to develop slowly and may include fever, headache, neck stiffness, altered mental state, and sensitivity to light. There's also parasitic meningitis, which is caused by parasites entering the body through various means, such as contaminated water, food, or through insect bites. Although this type is extremely rare, its symptoms overlap with other forms of meningitis, and it can be very dangerous if not diagnosed and treated promptly. In fact, you may have noticed that there's quite a bit of overlap of symptoms between all forms of meningitis. Therefore, it's important that if you suspect you or someone else may have meningitis, it's crucial to seek medical attention promptly, as meningitis can have potentially severe complications, including permanent neurological damage and even death. It should also be noted that meningitis can also result from non-infectious causes, including chemical reactions, drug allergies, some types of cancer, and inflammatory diseases. Because different forms of meningitis have similar symptoms, it's very important to have a prompt and accurate diagnosis so that appropriate treatment can be administered. To diagnose meningitis, healthcare professionals normally use a combination of methods, including reviewing the patient's medical history and conducting a physical examination, paying close attention to neurological signs. There are also a few important diagnostic procedures that may be involved, including a lumbar puncture, also known as a spinal tap, where a small amount of cerebrospinal fluid is withdrawn from the spinal canal to check for signs of infection, blood tests, where samples of blood are taken to identify the causative agent and assess the body's response to the infection, and imaging studies, where CT scans or MRIs may be performed to check for any complications such as brain swelling or abscesses. The treatment of meningitis primarily depends on the diagnosis and severity of the infection. Bacterial meningitis is a medical emergency and requires immediate administration of antibiotics and sometimes corticosteroids. Antibiotics cannot help with viral meningitis. However, most cases improve on their own in a few weeks. Treatment of mild viral meningitis usually involves bed rest, plenty of fluids, and pain medicine to help reduce fever and relieve body aches. If caused by the herpes virus, an antiviral medicine is also available. Fungal meningitis may require specific antifungal medications. Non-infectious meningitis due to allergic reaction or autoimmune disease may be treated with corticosteroids, and cancer-related meningitis requires therapy for the specific cancer. Fortunately, there are several preventative measures which can help reduce the risk of contracting meningitis. Vaccines are available against the common types of bacterial meningitis, including Haemophilus influenzae type B, meningococcal, and pneumococcal meningitis. Antibiotics can be taken as a preventative measure for close contacts of patients diagnosed with meningococcal disease to decrease the risk of transmission, and in general, maintaining good hygiene by practicing regular hand washing and avoiding close contact and sharing of personal items with individuals who have respiratory infections can also prevent transmission. And that's all for today's video. See you in the next one. This video is a part of Kenhub's limited clinical series and is for educational purposes only. It does not provide medical advice and none of the information in this video should be used as an alternative to a medical exam, specialist diagnosis, nor treatment. If you're feeling any health disorder symptoms, please contact your doctor.